Let us continue to assist him with our prayers. And let us pray for the Lord for ourselves. May you, as family and friends who mourn, be reunited one day with Wayne, and together may we meet Christ Jesus, for he who is our life and who is our glory. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, by your own 3 days in the tomb, you sanctified the graves of all who believe in you, and so made the grave a sign of hope that promises resurrection, even as it claims our mortal bodies. Grant that Wayne's remains may sleep here in peace until you awaken him to glory, for you are the resurrection and the life. Then he will see you face to face, and in your light will see light, and know the splendor of God, for you live and reign forever and ever. Chosen a short reading from the Gospel of Matthew to share with you today. This is probably one of my very favorite scripture readings, and for a couple reasons. First of all, it's different, and I sort of like things that are a little outside the box. So that's one reason. And the other reason, this is a parent's gospel. This is written for parents. And I think you'll understand when you read it. Jesus said to his disciples, when? In the future. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels are with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him. And he will separate them one from another as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right hand. Then the king will say to those on his left, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me a drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me, naked, and you clothed me, ill, and you cared for me. Then the righteous will question him and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry, or thirsty, or naked, or a stranger, or sick, and take care of you? The king will say to them in reply, whenever you did this for my brothers and sisters, you did it for me. Come prepared. This is the gospel of the Lord. I assume you're all getting ready for the holy day that's coming up in 2 weeks. You're all getting ready for Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. What the Jews are you not getting ready for Rosh Hashanah? We know that our Christian faith is grounded in the Jewish faith. Half of our scripture dedicated history of Jewish people. Who they were, where they went, what they did. We have the law, the book of Deuteronomy. And we also have some of the lyrics to their song. And I know you're going to be glad I'm not going to ask you to sing. But I would ask you to join with me in the chorus. Every song has a chorus, which is repeated, and every song has verses. So if you would join with me in the chorus and leave the verses to me, and the chorus of the song is, the Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. Fresh and green are the pastures where he gives me rest. Your peaceful waters, he leads me to revive my drooping spirit. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. He guides me along the correct path. He is true to his name. If I should walk in the valley of darkness, no evil would I fear. You were there with your crook and your staff, these you give me thank you. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. You prepared a banquet for me in the sight of my foes. My head was anointed with oil, my cup was overflowing. Surely goodness and kindness will follow me all the days of my life. In the Lord's own house shall I dwell forever and ever. The Lord is my shepherd. There is nothing I shall want. Words can be a source of great understanding. Words can be confusing. I'm always fascinated with words. And here's a piece of trivia for you. This is an interesting piece of trivia. I'm sure you've all read that classic book, Green Eggs and Ham. Do you know that there's only 53 vocabulary words in that book? 53. And when we stop and think of the hundreds of thousands of words that we know, to write us a book, 53 words, pretty phenomenal. But as we grow, we hear words and we, some way or another, make a subscription or subscribe to them a meaning. And sometimes the meaning is wrong, or sometimes, let me give you an example. I'm a little kid, and my parents are teaching me how to pray, teaching me to pray. And I learn, deliver us from eagles. What was I to know? Gotta watch out. Then I heard the correct word. Another word that got misdefined for me a little later in my life was the word commencement. For whatever reason, my sister went off to nurse's training, and when nurse's training was over, we had commencement. And so I defined the word commencement as over. And nothing could be further. It's just the opposite. But I saw end of the training and commencement. And it always confused me. In fact, I have to consciously think of the word commencement and ascribe the correct definition. It always confused me when I hear somebody say, well, let the band commence. And I go, they haven't even started yet. We know that the word means end. And probably the other word that is so misdefined in our book, as we define it, and even emotionally, is the word death. Because when we say death, it's like over, finished, done with, and there's nothing further than the truth. In actuality, in everything, there is no death. Truly, there is no death. Because those leaves, in short time, they will fall to the earth, and they will become something else. They will change. They don't end. And there's nothing more, there's nothing in our world that this is more true than in us as human persons. Because we know we have been breathed, that our divine soul has been breathed into us. It says in Genesis that God breathed his life into us. If that's true, then that soul that's reflected, that reflects God's life, doesn't end, it just changed. So our prayer today, Lord, for your faithful people, life is not ended, it's just changed. And when the body of our earthly dwelling lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place. That's the good news. That's the gospel. That's the word, what gospel means. It means, gospel means good news. And the good news today especially is that Wayne's life isn't over. It's not over. It's just changed. It's just different. But it takes faith. There's no evidence. There's no empirical evidence. It takes faith. And that's what our Christian faith brings to us, is that faith that his life is not over, it's just good. And sometimes I like to call people to a moment of meditation, to stop and think what Wayne's life was the second after he breathed his last breath. Consider that. Breathed his last breath, and at that second, his life changed. While being absent from your community, he finds himself in a total new community. A community made up of all the people that went before him, that he was part of their life here on earth. They are now welcomed him into the Father's kingdom, presented him to God the Most High. There was Leah on floor to welcome. I must say, I envy you have dad so long. By the time I was 25, both of my folks were gone. So I envy you have dad so long. But there were his parents. How I haven't a clue. That I haven't a doubt. And all the other people that went before him, his brothers and sisters, and boy, they had a big family. Let's see. There was Arlington, and Forrest, and G. Gene, Boone from Sean, and Georgetta, and Mildred, and Helen from Bart.
Wow.
That's a big family. And they were there along with Floyd to welcome Floyd and Adina to welcome. How wonderful is that? Now there's one part of that you shared with me when you said that one of your favorite things was to go to the VFW and hang out with his friends. I really identify with that because that was my dad's favorite thing. Sunday afternoon, he'd head off at his Denver. He'd head off to the VFW, and oftentimes he'd take me along, and we'd have dinner in the Lotus Room, which is like a Chinese restaurant at the VFW place. So I identify with that, and how much joy that brought him. But if we step back for a minute and say, all those people at the VFW that he shared time with, he was honored that. That's good news. Just amazing people. We mentioned we'd like to work with work. Who knows the people that we find? And especially the scouts. How much influence is loving scouts influenced you and influenced your kids and influenced his grandkids? Eagle Scouts? All, right? Influence. But those people that he influenced in the scouts that have gone before him are part of that community. That's wonderful. I mean, if we really truly believe that, this is a day of joy. Sure, sadness is a departure, no question. Tears of joy in your heart. That's the good news. That's the gospel. Now, I have another part to this that I believe, and I've always believed in. And people will come up and they say to me, Pastor, that's a church teaching. I believe like Will Rogers. I believe Will Rogers used to say, there ain't no courage in heaven. I don't want to go. So I absolutely believe that all those little people in the first place, and good people in the first place, and you must be surrounded by them now, I believe that all those critters are part of our eternity. I can't imagine eternity without the critters. Just can't imagine. So just as much as the boy Arlington and Forrest and Gene and Georgetta and Mildred and Helen and Barbara were part of his welcoming committee, there was one, right? And all the other crews that he had, the passing dogs that he had. I believe that, absolutely. And I'm really happy now because the Pope finally agrees. Pope Francis has finally come out and says, yes, the critters will be part of our world. That's the good news. That's the gospel of the Lord. So if we can step back for a moment and view that moment after his last breath, that all of the burdens that had weighed him down, physical, emotional, all those burdens, and now surrounded by all of them. Even Mary, sure. How wonderful is that? Good news. Gospel. Assuming we'll go our separate ways, let us take leave of Wayne. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness. May it strike our heart. One day we'll joyfully greet him. In the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Trusting in God, we have prayed together. We now come to this last prayer. There is sadness at parting, but we take from him, hope that one day we'll see him again and enjoy his home. Although this gathering of family and friends will disperse in sorrow, the mercy of God will gather us together again in the glorious coming. Therefore, let us console one another in the faith of the risen Christ. Saints of God, come to his aid, hasten to greet him, angels of the Lord. Receive the soul of his enemy, God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, now take it to himself. Receive his soul and present it to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant to him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. Receive his soul and present it to God the Most High. To you, Lord, we now now commend the soul of Wayne, your servant. In the sight of this world, he's now dead. In your sight, he lives forever. Forgive whatever sins he may have committed through human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace. We ask you this in the name of the risen Christ. And let us bow our heads and pray for God's blessing. Merciful Lord, you know the anguish of the sorrowful, and you are attentive to the prayers of the humble. Hear your people who cry out to you in their need, and strengthen the hope in your lasting goodness. And may the love of God and the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ bless us and console us, and gently wipe every tear from our eyes. And we ask God's holy blessing upon us, this day and forevermore. Amen.